Bald eagles were once a really rare bird in Indiana, but now they can be seen all over the state. They were recently delisted from the list of species of special concern after a long road to recovery. A lot of time and effort has been dedicated to delisting the bald eagle. This is a perfect example of that. This half tower, although it doesn't look like much now, was built in the 1980s and was where the reintroduction began, with the release of chicks from Alaska and Wisconsin.
In the early 80s, we selected the bald eagle for two reasons, this project. One is we needed a high-profile species that people would recognize for the tax checkoff that was passed in 1982. And we wanted to contribute to the national recovery objectives to eventually delist the bald eagle. Eagles visited Indiana regularly at various reservoirs around the state during the winter and the migration period. But bald eagles were not permanent residents of Indiana. They last nested in the state in 1897 out at the Kankakee Marsh in northwest Indiana. But they had not nested in the state since then. And we wanted to reintroduce the bald eagles to restore the bald eagle as a nesting resident of the Hoosier state. The other concern was the bald eagle was listed as endangered by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service at the time. And each state had a recommended goal to restore nesting eagles to contribute to the national recovery of the bald eagle. And so that was the main motivation for the design of our project, to help with the national recovery plan for the bald eagles with our objective of getting 5 nesting bald eagles in the state by the year 2000. Finding Al Parker was real gem. He was the heart and soul of taking care of those eagles and responsible largely for the success of the program.
And so in 86 is when I started and worked till 89, 4 years of putting birds out. And that got going essentially to build a monstrous structure to put these birds in. It had about 25 feet off the ground, a big platform deck with a bunch of cages. So 4 cages originally, and we added a fifth the next year, that were covered on one side and then open bars on the other. And then a hallway behind it, so we could stay in that hallway, observe the birds through this hack tower. So this big thing had to be built. Then also had to start gathering up food. So we knew we were going to be feeding these guys literally tons of meat.
We'd be there on site when the young birds would come in. They'd bring them in from the airport. They'd be inspected. Initial information would be taken from them, and then we would get them ready for placement into the hack tower the following day.
And then once they were here, we collected them from Wisconsin the first year, and then the 3 years after that, Wisconsin and Alaska. My job was to sit on the hack tower pretty much all the daylight hours. It was sitting and observing these guys, making sure they're all eating was the biggest and most important thing.
To protect them from intrusion, we put buoys out in the area to stop boat traffic into the area of the hack tower. We signed it. We used volunteers to protect it on weekends.
They're in the cages for about a month. And by the time they were ready to go, we would go in at night, capture them, check them over, weigh them, put a radio transmitter on their tail, and then some wing tags on them.
And then once they were released to fly, once they fledged from the hack tower, of course, they would be monitored throughout the day. And they had radio tags on them so that we could track them after they left the property.
For many years, that was really what we were doing. We're just kind of keeping tabs on who's where, you know, what bird watchers saw, what wing tag on what lake. And it was kind of cool to see some of these birds really ranged far. We had some of the Alaska birds that made it all the way back up into Alberta. And some of the birds just, you know, they're down in the Carolina coast, down in Texas, up in upper New York. They really went a lot farther than you would have thought. But the idea behind the hacking was that because we fed them at home base, once they'd wander like a bunch of, you know, James Deans all over the countryside. And then hopefully they would come home and find someplace nearby in Indiana to actually raise their own young. Once the nesting got underway, my job was to climb the trees and pull the chicks out and lower them to the ground. We had a team down there to do the banding and blood draws and health inspection and that kind of stuff before we hoist them back up and put them back in.
I assume responsibility for the Eagle Restoration Program in 1989, which was the last year of releases in the state of Indiana. We had, by the end of that summer, we had released 73 young eagles in Indiana at Lake Monroe. And so for the next 25 years of my career, I spent time monitoring those birds, trying to find nests and monitoring nests and the success of those nests, and also working with landowners to make sure those nests were successful and to establish a self-sustaining population of bald eagles in the state of Indiana. About half of the birds that we did release survived to obtain breeding age, which is about 5 years old. And many of those formed the basis of our recovering population. Almost all the nests in the early years had at least one Indiana released eagle associated with them. We started out slow. We had two nests in 1989. Our first successful nests were in 1991. Our population grew to about a dozen nests about 5 years later. And then from that period on, our population doubled, our nesting population doubled about every 5 years. You know, this is one of the greatest success stories in wildlife conservation, is the recovery of bald eagle populations. They were taken off the federal list in 2007. We had reached our goal in Indiana of sustaining a population of at least 50 nesting pairs. And so we took them off our state list in 2008. They became a special concern species, and now they've actually been taken off that list. So the future looks bright for bald eagles in Indiana and North America again.
The one thing that this Eagle Project really showed us is when people become serious about conservation, stuff happens. And it's not a small thing. You going from a bird that is non-existent, basically as a nesting bird in the state of Indiana, there's nobody in Indiana who wants to see an eagle that can't. There's nobody. You can find them pretty much anywhere. That's an amazing thing to have happen. But it's because people got serious about it, you know, and the non-game tax checkoff paved the way for that so that people could actually, you know, put their money where their mouth is. If you believe in conservation, then do it.
In the 1980s, there were no bald eagles' nests. However, in 2020, the year that they were delisted, there were 396 nests reported in 88 of the 92 counties in Indiana. The reason why we know this information is because we rely on reports from the public, people like you. You can send us reports just by emailing us. However, we recommend that you stay at least 330 feet from the nest to minimize disturbance and that you do not publicize those reports because bald and golden eagles are still protected under federal law. Over the years, a lot of people have been involved in making the bald eagle recovery a conservation success story, from multiple government agencies, organizations, to everyday citizens like you. You can continue to conserve non-game species by donating to the Indiana Nongame Wildlife Fund online or through your taxes. And we at the Indiana DNR, thank you.